This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. The Meaning of Relativity by Albert Einstein. Lecture 1: Space and Time in Pre-Relativity Physics. The theory of relativity is intimately connected with the theory of space and time. I shall therefore begin with a brief investigation of the origin of our ideas of space and time, although in doing so I know that I am introducing a controversial subject. The object of all science, whether natural science or psychology, is to coordinate our experiences and to bring them into a logical system. How are our customary ideas of space and time related to the character of our experiences? The experiences of an individual appear to us arranged in a series of events. In this series, the single events which we remember appear to be ordered according to the criterion of earlier and later, which cannot be analyzed further. There exists, therefore, for the individual, an I-time or subjective time. This in itself is not measurable. I can, indeed, associate numbers with the events in such a way that a greater number is associated with the later event than with an earlier one, but the nature of this association may be quite arbitrary. This association I can define by means of a clock by comparing the order of events furnished by the clock with the order of the given series of events. We understand by a clock something which provides a series of events which can be counted, and which has other properties of which we shall speak later. By the aid of speech, different individuals can, to a certain extent, compare their experiences. In this way, it is shown that certain sense perceptions of different individuals correspond to each other, while for other sense perceptions, no such correspondence can be established. We are accustomed to regard as real those sense perceptions which are common to different individuals, and which therefore are, in a measure, impersonal. The natural sciences, and in particular the most fundamental of them, physics, deal with such sense perceptions. The conception of physical bodies, in particular of rigid bodies, is a relatively constant complex of such sense perceptions. A clock is also a body, or a system, in the same sense, with the additional property that the series of events that it counts is formed of elements, all of which can be regarded as equal. The only justification for our concepts and system of concepts is that they serve to represent the complex of our experiences. Beyond this, they have no legitimacy. I am convinced that the philosophers have had a harmful effect upon the progress of scientific thinking in removing certain fundamental concepts from the domain of empiricism, where they are under our control, to the intangible heights of the a priori. For even if it should appear that the universe of ideas cannot be deduced from experience by logical means, but is, in a sense, a creation of the human mind, without which no science is possible, nevertheless this universe of ideas is just as little independent of the nature of our experiences as clothes are of the form of the human body. This is particularly true of our concepts of time and space, which physicists have been obliged by the facts to bring down from the Olympus of the a priori in order to adjust them and put them in a serviceable condition. We now come to our concepts and judgments of space. It is essential here also to pay strict attention to the relation of experience to our concepts. It seems to me that Poincaré clearly recognized the truth in the account he gave in his book, La Science et la Hypothèse. Among all the changes which we can perceive in a rigid body, those are marked by their simplicity, which can be made reversibly by an arbitrary motion of the body. Poincaré calls these changes in position. By means of simple changes in position, we can bring two bodies into contact. The theorems of congruence, fundamental in geometry, have to do with the laws that govern such changes in position. For the concept of space, the following seems essential. We can form new bodies by bringing bodies B, C, up to body A. We say that we continue body A, we can continue body A in such a way that it comes into contact with any other body X. The ensemble of all continuations of body E, we can designate as the space of the body A. Then it is true that all bodies are in the space of the arbitrarily chosen body A. In this sense, we cannot speak of space in the abstract, but only of the space belonging to a body A, the Earth's crust plays such a dominant role in our daily life in judging the relative positions of bodies that it has led to an abstract conception of space which certainly cannot be defended. In order to free ourselves from this fatal error, we shall speak only of bodies of reference, or space of reference. It was only through the theory of general relativity that refinement of these concepts became necessary, as we shall see later. I shall not go into detail concerning those properties of the space of reference which lead to our conceiving points as elements of space, and space as a continuum. Nor shall I attempt to analyze further the properties of space which justify the conception of continuous series of points or lines. If these concepts are assumed, together with their relation to the solid bodies of experience, then it is easy to say what we mean by the three-dimensionality of space. To each point, three numbers, x1, x2, x3, coordinates, may be associated in such a way that this association is uniquely reciprocal, and that x1, x2, and x3 vary continuously when the point describes a continuous series of points, a line. It is assumed in pre-relativity physics that the laws of the orientation of ideal rigid bodies are consistent with Euclidean geometry. What this means may be expressed as follows: two points marked on a rigid body form an interval. Such an interval can be oriented at rest, relatively to our space of reference, in a multiplicity of ways. If now the points of this space can be referred to coordinates x1, x2, x3, in such a way that the differences of the coordinates increment, x1 increment, x2 increment, x3 of the two ends of the interval furnish the same sum of squares. For every orientation of the interval, then the space of reference is called Euclidean and the coordinates Cartesian. It is sufficient indeed to make this assumption in the limit for an infinitely small interval. Involved in this assumption, there are some which are rather less special, to which we must call attention on account of their fundamental significance. In the first place, it is assumed that one can move an ideal rigid body in an arbitrary manner. In the second place, it is assumed that the behavior of ideal rigid bodies towards orientation is independent of the material of the bodies and their changes of position, in the sense that if two intervals can once be brought into coincidence, they can always and everywhere be brought into coincidence. Both of these assumptions, which are of fundamental importance for geometry and especially for physical measurements, naturally arise from experience. In the theory of general relativity, their validity needs to be assumed only for bodies and spaces of reference which are infinitely small compared to astronomical dimensions. The quantity S we call the length of the interval. In order that this may be uniquely determined, it is necessary to fix arbitrarily the length of a definite interval. For example, we can put it equal to 1 unit of length. Then the lengths of all other intervals may be determined. If we make the x nu linearly dependent upon a parameter lambda, we obtain a line which has all the properties of the straight lines of the Euclidean geometry. In particular, it easily follows that by laying off n times the interval s upon a straight line, an interval of length ns is obtained. A length, therefore, means the result of a measurement carried out along a straight line by means of a unit measuring rod. It has a significance which is as independent of the system of coordinates as that of a straight line, as will appear in the sequel. We come now to a train of thought which plays an analogous role in the theories of special and general relativity. We ask the question, besides the Cartesian coordinates which we have used, are there other equivalent coordinates? An interval has a physical meaning which is independent of the choice of coordinates, and so has the spherical surface which we obtain as the locus of the endpoints of all equal intervals that we lay off from an arbitrary point of our space of reference. If x nu as well as x nu nu from 1 to 3 are Cartesian coordinates of our space of reference, then the spherical surface will be expressed in our two systems of coordinates by the equations. How must the x nu be expressed in terms of the x nu in order that equations 2 and 2a may be equivalent to each other? Regarding the x nu expressed as functions of the x nu, we can write by Taylor's theorem for small values of the increment x nu. If we substitute 2a in this equation and compare with 1, we see that the x nu must be linear functions of the x nu. If we therefore put or, then the equivalence of equations 2 and 2a is expressed in the form. It therefore follows that lambda must be a constant. If we put lambda equals 1, 2b, and 3a furnish the conditions, in which according as the conditions 4 are called the conditions of orthogonality and the transformations 3, 4, linear orthogonal transformations. If we stipulate that shall be equal to the square of the length in every system of coordinates, and if we always measure with the same unit scale, then lambda must be equal to 1. Therefore, the linear orthogonal transformations are the only ones by means of which we can pass from one Cartesian system of coordinates in our space of reference to another. We see that in applying such transformations, the equations of a straight line become equations of a straight line. Reversing equations 3a, by multiplying both sides by bnb and summing for all the new s, we obtain the same coefficients, b, also determine the inverse substitution of increment x nu. Geometrically, b na is the cosine of the angle between the x nu axis and the x alpha axis. To sum up, we can say that in the Euclidean geometry, there are, in a given space of reference, preferred systems of coordinates, the Cartesian systems, which transform into each other by linear orthogonal transformations. The distance s between two points of our space of reference, measured by a measuring rod, is expressed in such coordinates in a particularly simple manner. The whole of geometry may be founded upon this conception of distance. In the present treatment, geometry is related to actual things, rigid bodies, and its theorems are statements concerning the behavior of these things, which may prove to be true or false. One is ordinarily accustomed to study geometry, divorced from any relation between its concepts and experience. There are advantages in isolating that which is purely logical and independent of what is, in principle, incomplete empiricism. This is satisfactory to the pure mathematician. He is satisfied if he can deduce his theorems from axioms correctly, that is, without errors of logic. The question as to whether Euclidean geometry is true or not does not concern him. But for our purpose, it is necessary to associate the fundamental concepts of geometry with natural objects. Without such an association, geometry is worthless for the physicist. The physicist is concerned with the question as to whether the theorems of geometry are true or not. That Euclidean geometry, from this point of view, affirms something more than the mere deductions derived logically from definitions may be seen from the following simple consideration. Between endpoints of space there are redistances, s micro nu. Between these and the 3n coordinates we have the relations. From these equations the 3n coordinates may be eliminated, and from this elimination at least equations in the s micro nu will result since the s micro nu are measurable quantities and by definition are independent of each other. These relations between the s micro nu are not necessary a priori. From the foregoing, it is evident that the equations of transformation 3, 4 have a fundamental significance in Euclidean geometry, in that they govern the transformation from one Cartesian system of coordinates to another. The Cartesian systems of coordinates are characterized by the property that in them the measurable distance between two points, s, is expressed by the equation. If kx nu and kx nu are two Cartesian systems of coordinates, then the right-hand side is identically equal to the left-hand side on account of the equations of the linear orthogonal transformation, and the right-hand side differs from the left-hand side only in that the x nu are replaced by the x nu. This is expressed by the statement that n ary summation increment x nu 2 is an invariant with respect to linear orthogonal transformations. It is evident that in the Euclidean geometry, only such and all such quantities have an objective significance, independent of the particular choice of the Cartesian coordinates, as can be expressed by an invariant with respect to linear orthogonal transformations. This is the reason that the theory of invariance, which has to do with the laws that govern the form of invariance, is so important for analytical geometry. As a second example of a geometrical invariant, consider a volume. This is expressed by means of Jacobi's theorem, we may write, where the integrand in the last integral is the functional determinant of the x nu with respect to the x nu, and this by 3 is equal to the determinant, b micro nu, of the coefficients of substitution, b na. If we form the determinant of the delta micro alpha.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.